Oh wow, I bet you haven't heard that sound in a while. The JD Clarity ping and Gareth, of course, that's me in the studio, ready to bring you Mr. Cat EU Invitational as the draft has begun. And I also have a lovely special
Ring
guest.
ding
As soon as I
bell.
unmute him, Trent is here as well joining me. What's up, man?
Oh, hello, hello. Good morning. Well, I suppose good afternoon over there, as it is finally EU stuff that we're doing here. Not too many EU things going on these days, honestly, in terms of like online tournaments and stuff. It feels like a lot of it is focused down that SEA region and, of course, China.
China's had so
But,
many. Like, China had,
yeah.
like, you know, there's
I
like
mean, they never
in-house
stop.
leagues and DPL and everything else. Like, oh, it's so good. I guess for EU, there's like Pro Dota and a couple of other things, but
Dude,
it's
they
been
have
quiet.
so many online leagues in China. Wings just like couldn't even make it to TI. They're just, free invite. I can't do it, guys. It's too much. And
Too
they just
much.
failed. That's pretty much what happened.
Oh, man. Well, there's a great story behind these two teams, right? You know, we were watching them through the Kiev
Dire team
qualifiers.
bell.
They both performed very well. Team Empire got knocked out by Na'Vi, and Empire and sorry, NiP kind of got to that stage where they got to the playoffs, and it's like, right, well, we have to face up against Bears and Team Secret, who are like two of the biggest favorites, and they got kicked out. But
10 seconds
you know, NiP,
remaining.
they've obviously had a bit of a roster swap. Sindh out for Insania in. And when
Reigning
you lose
team
someone of the
bell.
caliber of Syndra, you know, the kind of in-game leading, the experience, the drafting knowledge, sometimes that is a difficult hole to fill. But we'll find out how they do. While Empire, they did pretty well at DAC, hey?
Yes, quite well. So,
Ten
well, we'll have to
seconds
see if
remaining.
they can keep that going. I've seen them a couple times since as well. We had them
Ten
for
seconds
two
remaining.
separate best of fives, one of which was up against NIP. So, seen a little bit of this matchup.
Reserved
And then they
team
subsequently 3-0'd Cloud9. But not only did they 3-0 Cloud9,
team
but Team Empire picked 14 different heroes across
pick.
those three games. They picked Crystal Maiden twice, and that was it. So, they have a ton of versatility right now, like numerous heroes they're willing to work with. There was an Arc Warden thrown in there. We had some like PA troll stuff going on. We had some Legion IO. So that like that
Radiant
second
team
phase for Team
bell.
Empire, I think, is terrifying because you have no idea what they're going to go with.
No idea at all. And of course, we're coming straight out of the Kiev Major, where we've seen, you know, kind of the sub-meta from that tournament, or at least from the playoffs, kind of developed through group stages. Then with the big teams at the grand final,
10 seconds
see a few
remaining.
kind of flavor heroes come out, and Doombringer was one of them. Now, he picked up
Five
a
seconds
number of times
remaining.
in the off lane, a little bit of 4-all Doom kind of sprinkled
I
in here
see
and
no
there, but it looks like that's
change.
what Team Empire will be going for. One of
Dire
their
team
kind of
bell.
old favorites from the CIS region was that roaming Doom that you know, Puppy and the lads used to bring out every now and then. But Nature's Prophet. Now, there was a player fantasy card thing in the compendium, and that was all nice and good.
Radiant
But there was
team
also a
bell.
third party site where you could choose heroes to win points
Oh
with.
yes, the fantasy EU or something,
Yeah.
right?
So before it all started, I was talking to Knoxville, who lives with me, is my flatmate, talking to Ben, and I basically told, like, he told me, right, Crystal Maiden's been picked, you know,
10 seconds
148 times
remaining.
over the past, you know, 300 matches or something. That's like a hero we have to have. And I was
Five
like, hey, Ben,
seconds
Spectre's going to do
remaining.
really well. We threw a Spectre in there. And we did, you know, reasonably well. I got top six, barely
Reserve
beaten out
team.
of top five. Ben got second place, I think. But Nature's Prophet was a hero that, like, came out at the end of group stages and the start of playoffs of Kiev that really surprised us, because it was like being first phase banned and second phase banned against like Thunderbirds and Liquid and people like
Dire
this.
team
One of those
bell.
things that's like being played in scrims. From what little you saw from it, like, how do you feel about that hero?
I think he's the
Radiant
classic
team
example of like
bell.
the little buffs adding up until everyone like I would say even last patch, I think we saw a couple people like kind of testing the waters. They're feeling it out and it kind of went okay, but they didn't go all in, you know? They weren't just like picking, slamming Prophet down every game, Admiral Bulldog style or anything like
Ten
that.
Yeah.
seconds
But
remaining.
it's just incremental buffs over time. That last one just
Five
completely tipped them, though.
seconds
The ba it
remaining.
was a base damage buff, right? For like a very early game, and like your last hitting is insane. You
Reserve
don't even need
team
a null
bell.
talisman on this guy. You go to lane with brown boots, and you're just denying the carry. And he's very difficult to deal with if you don't have either one support who's extremely good against Treants, which isn't exactly the easiest thing to do. Most of those supports tend to be like good against one unit, right? Your
Yep.
Crystal Maiden or something. The whole
Dire
wave of them
team
is
bell.
just a total bastard, and they hit very hard. If you're a low armor support, like good luck. You need to be like Ogre or something, just running and punching Prophet.
It's super hard, and I think we came to the conclusion that maybe there was a Nature's Prophet Lycan like combo to go in there. Because, you know, at nighttime you get, I think you get like 1600 HP treants or something once you're both level 25, because the treants get the HP perk and like damage perk, and there's like a million of them. Then you have Aghanim's Refresher
and the Howl.
So you have like, I don't know, like 2k HP treants that are hitting for, you know, a hero's worth of damage. And a bunch of us UK lads play in like this, you know, UK league, which is sort of, you know, 4.5 to 6.5, 7k players or whatever. And we're like a 5k MMR average team. And we instantly, the next game after seeing this Nature's Prophet, we're like, right, Lycan Nature's Prophet or Nature's Prophet Spectre or something like that. And it doesn't matter how poorly you do in the early game, as long as mid game you get Fury and some items, you just A move the trees onto the enemy towers and no one do anything.
Yeah. And I will say, my only thing that I tend to notice with the Nature's Prophet, obviously he's a very high damage offlaner, right? He's not like a traditional controlling element, really. So it's very nice to have someone like that positioned for like Earth Spirit or someone who just brings tons of team fight. But they've gone for the Doom, so he's like, he's got that sustain, which is nice, and he's definitely a frontliner. He just like runs in and punches people and he screams, "Deal with me," and it disrupts the enemy's team fight. But this is a really nice pickup because of this. They're gonna go with the Disruptor, probably one of the heaviest team fight position fives overall. You know, he doesn't have those defensive options of like a Dazzle or something, or the nuking prowess of some other fives, but he's right in there with that solid AoE lockdown. Might just need perhaps a little bit more help from either the position one or the mid laner in terms of like some AoE stuns.
I guess both of the heroes, Furion and Doom, they're kind of, you know, good against BKB carriers, right? So NIP will be looking at this and thinking, well, they've got some magic damage from Disruptor, this teamfight control. We kind of need a BKB carrier to go up against that. But then you need Lincoln Spheres and stuff to go on your Invoker. Nature's Prophet holds you in the trees regardless of what you have. So it's kind of, I feel, a nice bridge the three heroes the Empire have of, like, Doom controlling mobile heroes, Furion controlling BKB heroes, Disruptor being that big sort of teamfight ulti regardless of what people are doing. And, you know, maybe once you get to Zaganim Scepter, going to think about locking down the BKB holders as well, while NIP like desperately need a building hitter, and it's going to be the Lycan.
There he is. Well, it's hard to pass up on that guy. He's definitely getting the respect these days. You know, my problem with him is that I like Nightstalker as a hero, but you do not want to play Nightstalker against Lycan, because you're just going to like be buffing him the whole game. It's so depressing. He's like on the enemy team, and he's like, "Oh, thank you for this nighttime. Let me just double effect Howl my entire team." So that's lovely.
What team did
of course
that?
The synergy's there though.
What team did that at Kiev? It was like in the semifinals or something, I think.
Yeah, it was in the semis. I can't remember who it was either.
Was it OGEG? I can't remember. But yeah, someone picked Nightstalker and they were just like, "Okay, well, you have Nightstalker. I'm going to pick Lycan straight away." Maybe it wasn't the semis, because it wasn't EG OG, and I don't think it was.
Maybe it was SVEG? Maybe it was like that quarters or something.
Maybe it was the end of the quarterfinals, that kind of weird long series that went on for freaking ever. I don't know. It was game two. EG picked the Lycan after the King RD Nightstalker. That's the one.
Oh, there you go. Jeez, I tell you, I mean, if there's ever a time to do it, this wouldn't be a bad Nightstalker game for NIP. They play the Sand King in the 4 or the 3. Trixie has a good one. Hani has a nice one. There's still the Earth Spirit as well if they want that like catch out potential for like a Nature's Prophet and Ember Spirit. But Nightstalker would be able to provide that as well. It's a little bit slower to come online, but the silence is very powerful against Ember. It's okay versus Disruptor and Doom if you get into the back lines, and then you're closing out the vision of Glimpse too. So there's a lot of synergy there if you want to just bring the Nightstalker for yourself for NIP.
Yeah, definitely could work. And you bring out the name of Hani, and I think that honestly on this team, he's kind of been the big surprise for me. You know, he had a long hiatus out of playing professional Dota. He was doing some sort of, you know, management jobs and working in sort of producing and things like that for a number of companies. Comes back to Dota 2 into NIP, and there were a lot of question marks around him. You know, I think his MMR was like 5.6k. You know, he was definitely sub 6k when he rejoined Ninjas in Pyjamas with this squad. And it was like, how well is he going to do? But his roaming 4, you know, the first like 20 games he played nothing but Crystal Maiden, right? He pretty much has played CM every game. Yeah. But his Sand King, his Monkey King, his roaming heroes have been exceptional. But I'm not sure if
his Monkey King is crazy. He had like 9 kills one game at, I think it was 7 minutes or something. I couldn't believe how like low leveled he was, just because like the way experience in gold is these days is combat mechanics and like how you're stomping, it doesn't do too much. But my god, he was just had an absolute tear.
He did have an iron shell. I was what you were casting that. I was watching that game. It was like iron shell monkey just like running into enemy jungle, and he killed the invoker, then the crystal maiden, and someone else. Just like all within the space of like 40 seconds. Like okay, well our jungle
that was
isn't
crazy actually.
It's not really ours anymore. Arc Warden taken out. Hero that you know OG played a little bit. Team Empire, they do like the meme heroes though. Hey, Chappie.
Yeah, they played it. They won a game against Cloud9 with it actually.
Oh, nice. I mean, Chappie with like Meepo and PA and Arc Warden and all these funky things. You're never quite sure what he's going to come out with. But with this final hero, now we're looking at Furion offlane, Ember mid, Disruptor as your kind of five support, at least lane support for the early sort of 3-4 minutes, maybe with a TP. Potential if things get a bit dodgy, but Doom jungling is going to be, or Doom sort of, you know, semi jungle, semi roam is probably how we look at it. Maybe in a bit of trouble if Crystal Maiden and Sand King decide to roam, but I feel like Lycan can do okay against Furion once he gets a couple of levels.
I could see Doom coming up there though, and with the treants and with Doom and just like punching him, that could be very obnoxious.
That could be nasty. So, what do you want for Chappie then? Do you
Probably that's a little bit of, like, you want to be pretty strong, right? Like, that Jug-style hero, maybe not him himself, someone with a little bit more lockdown for this Lycan.
I mean, something that we haven't really talked about was the potential of, you know, the one-roll Furion or the one-roll Doom, which we have seen in the past from especially Russian teams or CIS teams. But Razor, one of the kind of hard counters to Lycan, just static link him up, stun him for a little bit or catch him in the kinetic field. You drain all that damage out, and he does become a much weaker force to deal with. I feel Empire also are looking pretty good for scaling to the sort of mid to late game. NIP needs to really round this together with, I don't know if it's going to be their offlane hero, Beastmaster maybe?
Yeah, it's either the Sand King offlane. Beastmaster's not a bad option. It has to be someone, I don't know. That lockdown is so heavily dependent on the Sand King right now. Like, he's the guy who has to catch out this tree and this Ember Spirit if they end up in some sort of, like, a slight rap battle. Of course, yes, now they have a Darkseer, so there's not many sustain offlaners left these days. They don't get picked too often, so at least he's going to have this mech. If they do get the ball rolling, you're going to have Arcane Aura going. You have the Darkseer with the Arcane Aura, which means that you're, like, not nerfed in lane anymore after the Iron Shell mana changes and how much that hurt the heroes, so... If they get going, get a mech up. You basically are the like team fountain with the help of Lycan, so could see them snowballing.
And Crystal Maiden, I guess, with that arcane aura just like helping everyone out. But I honestly look at this and I feel Team Empire pretty much just win lanes outright. And NIP need to kind of weather the storm for the first maybe even 20 minutes, you know, 15, 20 minutes. Try and hold their tier 1s, maybe take the enemy offlane tier 1 as quickly as they can. Because Darkseer and Invoker, notoriously slow heroes coming out of the laning stage, you know. They need Arcane Sol Ring mech, they need Hand of Midas Aghanims for Invoker, so they get their kind of primary itemization up and running by about 20 minutes. But then you also look at Sand King, who would like a Blink Dagger. He's going to be this roaming active role. Maybe if they, I don't know, aggro tri-lane or aggro dual lane, like you were mentioning with the Doom going up with the Nature's Prophet, if Sand King, Darkseer go aggro dual lane against a Razor, that could cause some difficulties, as... Oh yes. Oh yes. I've not seen this in such a long time, Trent. You will notice that there are a couple of interesting names. There's no ticket yet for Mr. Cat EU. So
all right.
Yeah.
Let's take a look here then. I think they're all correct here. That is headlines is Hani, so that's expected role. Dota is fun, is Trixie. Man, he's had that avatar like forever. And then that's Mickey, of course, so we got a stand in today. Low tier trash player, excellent, still Era.
And Insania is light. Actually doing a nice little move here. Trying to scout out, hiding his obs and sentries up on the high ground so no one can see it from across the river, while Doom, he's actually still smoked. Doesn't get revealed out by the CM. Smoke will wear off, but I think he got back into fog just in time. But yeah, Radiant team, Empire. Oh boy, they've got funny names as well, Trent.
Class.
I'm just gonna sit there and baby rage the entire time.
So Inspired is King R. That's his tag, I believe, when he plays.
Okay. And Beethoven
That's
is
confirmed. That's normal. All right.
Beethoven is FN because Razor is Chappie, so FN is the Ember Spirit.
And that is Maposhka on
On
the Doom.
the
So
Doom.
everything's pretty
Maposhka is Chinese now, apparently.
the overall normal. And then that's just Ghost Stick there on the Prophet. We
Cool.
did it.
Excellent. Good job. Well done, Trent. You have carried me through the player names and the weird things. And Senia gets forced back and Ghost Stick. Well, Empire looks like they might start with three bounty runes here. They're gonna get three, and Mikka will
Look at
take.
this, look at this Lycan up here.
Oh boy.
He just has to run. Like, this is a Lycan. You're not supposed to be running from an offlaner.
He has two slippers.
You're supposed to fight him.
He's gone for the two slippers build because he wants his early PMS. But of
Oh.
course, he doesn't have the money to go and actually buy the Stout Shield just yet. He's got to wait for the next wave to come in to last it. So, you know, he loses a Tango after getting burnt a third of his HP just by right clicks. You know,
It's brutal, man.
you're mentioning, what is it, 62 average base
62
damage?
with brown boots. Like,
That's disgusting. That's
oh.
actually
He just
disgusting.
changes the lanes so much from what you expect. You know, usually you're the carry, you see that offer, you just wanna punch him. You're like, yeah, get this guy. CM, get over here, man. I got him. You
Ooh.
can't fight this dude.
And also, Darkseer, of course, goes level 1 Iron Shell like 95% of the time. Very, very, very rarely do we see the DS go, you know, surge for the escape capability, which is something that used to happen probably a little more often. But Razor with his Static Link is able to, you know, drain out all the damage and put so much more pressure and focus onto the DS in lane. It's a bit nasty for Trixie. He's still stuck at level 1 and struggling to get 2, but it's mid lane where the roam comes in. It's Hani, the Sunstrike from Invoker. Oh, barely lands, but. Looks like FN will scuttle away as far as he possibly can. I don't know if he's going to deny himself to Ancients or something, because
I
Hani
was gonna say,
still
we
hot
got
on his
that 30
tail.
move
He
speed.
cuts the tree down, a couple of hits from the dragons, and he will deny.
That's rough. You're hoping for that like low roll from the dragon or something. Maybe he won't die, but no such luck. So no first blood, and yeah, as you're saying, bottom like. Yeah, Disruptor very good against Darkseer in these solo situations, but this is where he really suffers. Like 2v2. I could see this lane going pretty poorly for the Radiant. In fact, Disruptor
He's
just
just
rolls
TP.
on mid.
He's like, screw this, I'm out of this lane. I'm TPing mid, lads. They're actually going to move in the Ember Spirit as well. I mean, I guess Disruptor leeches a bit of experience there before FN returns. I want to go in on this. Thunderstrike level 1, he's got a point to give. And that's a glimpse, actually. Back into FN. Chains at the ready, but Mikka, with the Alacrity, there's the chains to hold him down. The Sunstrike will not land onto anyone. And Hani
How
was a
does
little
that
bit too
work?
late.
I mean, he saw him punching creeps, and he saw him TP in.
Yeah, I don't know,
He
buddy.
still gets punished. I guess he just was not respecting the distance of the glimpse level one. I mean, I know it's low, but it's not that low.
Oh, meanwhile, up towards the Crystal Maiden, it's the Doom and the Furion punishing. All but Venom Brown Boots on this Doom, and of course we've got Ghost Stick closing in on his lovely little phase boots doing the taunt, of course, but. Last hit-wise, Radiant team, they're coming out like way ahead in this. Darkseer's shut down, he's what, still level 3 using the shrine now. But there's just, this is the thing, right? There's very little to no pressure from the Dire team, apart from Alacrity onto. Oh god, that's not meant to happen! This is not. Okay, mid lane is just, I don't know, screwed up. There's something wrong with this.
Yeah, sometimes, I don't know, you go for these dives and you're getting these kills and stuff, so the lane gets weird because your HP values are strained, then you're like trying to get certain levels and stuff. I don't know. That's my assumption there, but a little bit odd.
We
Just
need
comes back in, gives him the pretty blessed RNG right there.
Oh, bloody hell. My PC is switched from English keyboard layout to German, so the Z and Y are switched, and I'm just pressing Y and wondering why the hell it's not bringing up net worth. But the glimpse back into mid, the Ghost Walk, the sentry's down, the clap out, and Mikka looks like he's dead. The three-man roam into mid with the help of Fury and actually TPing in behind as well. No route of escape for the Invoker, and you just look at the two supports from Nip as well. Sand King and Crystal Maiden were kind of in the vicinity. But none of them fast enough to move in, as Inspired is hit by a Burst Strike Sunstrike combo, but again, it's just not enough damage. Insania slows the advance, Frostbite onto Doom, but looks like Maposhka wants to keep on going in. I think Syrian Chain's gone onto mid, he's taking a lot of damage there, and Hani misses a Burst Strike. NIP, things are not going your way.
And all I can say is that it looks like no one told SG Esports about this Prophet taunt, or else we definitely would have been getting this guy picked by them. That is quite the taunt. It's got music and everything. It's like before they nerfed the Shadow Fiend one.
Oh, that SF taunt It was so annoying.
It was too strong. It was literally it was. Too strong. They had to nerf it.
And the Alchemist one, the...
That stupid one
with the organ or whatever. Right, here we go. This is the pressure we're looking for. Bottom lane, Sunstrike out with a Burst Strike. Oh, it's enough to kill Chappie at the very least. But now, Inspired... it's okay. They've got Vision. They've got another Burst Strike in a second. And it will land. Hani does not miss out on this one. So they turn one into two. NIP get themselves back on the board. That's much, much better now. And Invoker, you know, helping out, gets a bit of shared experience, and he's doing relatively well now against this Ember in the 1v1.
Yeah, and the other thing is that, like, that's why the Disruptor basically left bottom earlier. It's because when there's a Starkseer and the Sand King, like, what is he going to do? All he's going to do is take levels away from his Razor in that situation. So it was a pretty cool rotation mid that helped him get that first kill on the Invoker and everything, but... Disruptor, extremely good against solo Darkseers. You know, he tries to surge away, you just glimpse him back in, but once there's a second hero there, it is just awful. And nice deep ward here by the Dire side will catch out this rotation coming in. So, they'll know King Air is on the prowl for a ward.
Well, he gets it.
They also saw the courier keep going, so they might know that there's a second hero here too.
Well, that's right. I mean, they'll definitely see it on the way back now as well, and I think that's why... Trixie's Darkseer is just hugging this tier 1. Invoker farms the jungle. Yeah, you called it there, Trent. They know exactly what's up, and NIP react and adapt accordingly. While the two-man gank squad of CM Sand King, they've got eyes on this Razor at bottom lane. I think they need another TP to come down to actually kill him off, but he's popped his ult to shove this lane.
Kind of look at that circle drawn by the Invoker. In here, this looks scary. I need help, guys.
My jungle is not my jungle, please. Please reclaim this land.
Oh, and you can't see that Doom either.
Oh, that's unfortunate.
It's not really much you can do with Leech.
He's gonna devour it as well. And he kills the Ford Spirit. Okay.
Oh, that was a win. All right, Mapushka, I see you. Nicely done. Oh, then you leave the Little Wolf too? Oh, yeah. The full play. There we go. 7 minutes. Not going to be a new creep camp.
Doesn't respawn. Try stack that. Invoker is... to move himself across, so this Midas is going to be here like, you know, 10-11 minutes. Through Sun Strikes, amazing things can happen, and it looks like they are setting up on bot lane for one. Dire Observer Ward not quite catching any vision of the Radiant Heroes. Razor shows himself on lane just to shove it out. Help against these Iron Shells coming through. And it seems so telegraphed and obvious. I don't know if the Radiant Obs at all spotted them near Rune Spot moving in, but it's just the fact that Sand King CM are off the map. And they've got, you know, Darkseer, Invoker, Lycan, three heroes who like to jungle. And if any two of those three heroes are off the map, you pretty much know that Sand King and CM aren't farming jungle, right?
They're going to try to play mid. They know where the Remnant is, it looks like. Or at least they have a good assumption as to where it's often going to be. So, unfortunately, they can't get the pressure from the Invoker.
That's a good Frostbite Sunstrike, and they actually get the kill.
That'll do.
Insania gets the last hit, though. Unfortunately, not the Invokers. And in comes Ghoststick. There's the Sprout. And look at that damage. It's just a couple of hits, and Insania's going to die. Another one sliced out there. It'll get spread across the two of them. And Mika's Invoker sitting on half HP. There's no Doom from this Doom, of course. Level 4 still. But Furion applying a lot of pressure.
Yeah, when the Doom's there, he's getting, like, plus 50 damage as well. Right now, he's just at the plus 24, but... that's fine with him. With a tower hitting. Man, I have a feeling I haven't seen this Lycan in forever. What's going on up here, Era? How you doing, man? Fred Armlet. Okay. Standard stuff.
Will he go into the Mask of Madness?
Mask of Madness.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know.
That was the big one for me because I even saw as the tournament progressed, people even going like Mom first before Armlet and then seeing where they would go.
Mm-hmm.
So like the Mask of Madness just helps them farm jungle so much better. Bottom lane, Chappie's caught. Power of NIP actually comes to a halt for a second. Now they turn with Ghoststick here. The Nature's Prophet, they glimpse back the Darkseer and try and trap him up. But in comes Lycan Era. He's got his eyes set onto the Disruptor, trying to juke through the trees. But this will be a unlikely a tower push as well as Furion. Well, it'll help the Razor escape by killing off the Sand King. A one-for-one exchange there, it looks like, as the Sunstrike. Got him! Mika, nicely played, realizing the TP power there will likely be used. And FN's Ember Spirit came in for a bit of a fight, found the Darkseer. He's on such low HP that he kind of has to retreat, or he'll give his bottle to Disruptor, fill it up with a magic of the fountain buff. Lovely stuff. And now NIP, they seem committed to this bottom lane.
Yeah, really cannot underscore just like how important that Sunstrike was for Mickey that he got that one in the fat. That was 400 gold. Like, that is just such a faster Midas. And obviously, the quicker you're getting that, the quicker you're accelerating your net worth by a significant margin. So, good stuff for him. Bottom lane, this could be trouble.
I think Era's going to die up on top first. Yeah, he does go down, and the Doom is dropped onto Darkseer. Bottom lane, looks like they'll disengage from each other. Crystal Maiden kill will just catch the end of that, but back up to Trixie, who's still doomed up, and he's just going to tick over. There's no way to deny himself or any incoming teammates. So across two lains, Empire gain a couple of juicy kills. And was it bottom lane NIP initiating onto Empire? Or was it Empire?
No, it was Empire coming in. They were trying to get a kill onto Era there on the Lycan, but unable to snag him up, so... They just pay the price with the old CM, you know, Asania, classic stuff.
Oh well.
You know, he's trying to learn from the Sindarin, you know? he's trying to replace that role.
Tank the gank, that's all you have to do.
It's difficult.
But, like you said, that Invoker Midas, you know, I was looking at the timing and thinking, right, that's going to be like 10 to 11 minutes at the kind of, you know, earliest for your period there, period of time for that Midas to come through. But he actually gets it 10 and a half minutes in, which, you know, is a nice little speed burst there for him. Denies the mid tower. But top lane, Chappie has TP'd up here while three heroes lurk from NIP.
We have a 350 Sunstrike right now, so this is pretty plausible. They need Frostbite into the Epicenter.
Sunstrike with the Epicenter as well. Lycan even sprints forward, and well, Chappie, you will drop, but Sandkin gives his life in exchange for this. In comes Ghoststick and Miposhka, now turning back onto Era. Oh, Insania, TP away. Have they any stuns? Doesn't look like it. Not enough damage either. And now the movement forward from FN. Spirit onto Mika. He's got his Invoke. A Tornado quickly will keep them locked down for a touch, but he doesn't have Ghostwalk anymore. They've had sentries anyway. Yeah, there we go. Disruptor now will be caught, though. They counter Sentry out, and Lycan with the Iron Shell up on him, chasing down this Disruptor. Static Storm, this might find them another one. Disruptor just hit the CM, kill the CM, one to trade, and that is beautiful out there from Empire. Turning a 1-for-1 into a 2-for-1.
Felt like that Wrath of Nature did quite a bit of damage too when it came in on the to Hani. Felt like it had like just finished its lap around the map, and that Sand King dropped from like 25% HP. Another one of those things that got a little bit of a buff lately.
I was like, where did Hani go? I swear he was like full HP a second ago. Well,
he just got obliterated.
Midas's Trent.
Yeah. We're not done yet, guys. We're still waiting on that balance patch. I gotta say, I'm very excited for the next couple of weeks, though, because I think we're expecting a pretty big shakeup, I would say, right? The lead up into TI, generally some pretty big changes.
Solar Crest, Midas, you know?
Yep. Can't really disagree with those ones, that's for sure.
We've already nerfed the Illusion Heroes. Time to start nerfing, you know, the Summon Heroes, like Lycan and Nature's Prophet, for no reason other than they have summons. Disruptor, you have dewarded, but you might be in trouble. Sand King's found you, he's got your number, and the Sunstrike will land and take the kill. But in comes the reinforcements. They're actually going to go in onto this. There's a Searing Chains down onto two. The damage output. Oh, CM can't get the ulti off too quick. And Mecha's dropped as well. A 3-for-1. They saw the tasty kill. The juicy Disruptor was all they wanted, but they couldn't escape from it. This mobility from Empire, so quick out of the gates with both Ember Spirit and Nature's Prophet just jumping across the map like that.
I mean, honestly, this is Tier 1 and Shrine, too. So, like, you're fighting to a place that has... You can TP in without delaying your allies. So you can quickly move a large number of heroes here. And, I don't know, like, Static Storm's not usually a hero... Oh, well, there you go, Dan Bond. Speaking of Static Storm.
Do they have the damage? The TP look decent, but Trixie still dies.
Yeah. It's not usually a cooldown you play around in terms of, like, oh, it's down, we need to push. That's kind of what that felt like, though. They're like, okay, it's Disruptor. We know he doesn't have it for, like, 20 more seconds. Like, let's go, and... They just got owned, like just absolutely crushed going into that hill. And then now you're just trying to get a little bit of split push action going on. You lose your Darkseer, who's still not in Dire Cane boots.
Oh man, that's really bad for Trixie. What's his net worth? 3,300.
Very low.
He's below the four all roaming Doom. But this is something that we talked about as the draft ended, right? The amount of greed and sort of the slow pace coming out of laning stage, Invoker and DS. They need their gold, they need their items, they need to farm jungle, but there's so much overlap from NIP, and that's where also you feel this, you know, pressure applied to themselves coming from. You know, they needed to be active, they needed to roam. CM and SK have just been running from lane to lane, just like, dude, Sunstrike someone. We'll stun someone. You sunstrike them. We'll just kill people, you know, time and time again. But they've been spotted, and with a TP forward, oh, he's not going to find them. CM and Sand King, they do retreat. But Dark's here now. Man. He needs to farm.
Yep. This game feels extremely difficult moving forward for Nip. They're going to have the wolves help scout, I suppose, which is handy, but the way I see this game going is that you just have this treant, or these treants, this Nature's Prophet just like constantly pushing these lanes. This Ember Spirit, he's doing the exact same thing. And then if you're trying to avoid these deaths on the Dire, you want to stick as a unit, but you physically can't stick as a unit. So someone's going to have to split up, and then you're going to have these glimpses coming in that's picking off the solo heroes. Like top lane, they can just kill this guy.
Looks like they can. Oh, that's really Later. Sad. That's really, really
like,
sad as well.
This is the game right there. That's just going to keep happening.
And they glimpse one back as well. Disruptor's not even going to get caught by the Sand King or the CM. They'll still continue chasing here as Trixie surges the Crystal Maiden forward. Are you going to get there in time? He's on the high ground.
They have three
He's
remnants.
Got the kinetic field. Yeah, and the Ember Spirit is right there next to him. I mean, this all started. NIP smoked three heroes, and they were the ones that were like, right, we are going to go and kill shit. And then they lose their Invoker top lane, and you're sort of thinking, well, what do you do with this? They had to react. They had to TP back. And now, Era's caught inside the trees. Luckily, he has a Quelling Blade. I don't know if they can block them in with the treants, but he turns the fight up against this. In comes Ember Spirit. They've got the chains. They've got the lockdown. The drums are popped out. The damage output, not quite good enough just yet. But with the Razor coming through, Era has to turn and run. Lycan back to the trees. The armlet will keep him alive for now. But Sand King was also waiting near that shrine. It's just another situation, though, where NIP are not comfortable sitting on this map.
Nice play from Era, though. Just understanding, again, there's not very much control on the spot, so he can push it pretty hard on the Lycan. I wouldn't mind seeing Maposhka ditch the Alpha Wolf if he wanted to pick up a stun, like be it net or something like that. I feel like it could really help them.
No.
We'll have to see.
No. Shut up. Shut up, Trent. Alpha Wolf is best.
That's always, no matter what.
Always. Okay, so if I go blink on on Doom, then I like the, you know, the Hellbear clap or the Centaur stun, because you can just blink in and slam people. But if I'm just going to be this Doom who has a Solar Crest and Tranquil Boots, and I'm just going to walk into fights and say, yeah, what up? Try.
Oh yeah, no, I don't disagree.
maybe the Hellbear would be good as well, because you've got the attack speed aura on that red guy as well. I don't know. I just really love damage, Trent. I really love damage.
When I watch this Doom, he has no weapon. He's just walking around with his fists, which looks awesome, by the way. This should just be a set. I think mine might just be bugged, though.
No, it's for me as well. The sword is invisible, apparently.
Excellent. He's just, like, backhanding these creeps. Quiet, or I'll eat you.
Lovely. A nice Chianti and some fava beans. Eating those creeps.
This chap, he's important Razor builds. Drums, S and Y. Went for the treads instead of the bots, which we saw like Ace doing a ton from said C9. Ross that we talked about earlier, but the treads helped fight obviously quite a bit earlier.
I swear Chappie hasn't done anything all game. He kind of just sat bot lane and was like, yeah, Doc's here, 1v1 me, I'll stop you from farming. And then he's kind of just moved from lane to lane to farm even more. I guess at this point now, Empire are like mega strong. They can probably just 5-man the towers if they wanted to. You know, tier 1 bot still standing, tier 2's mid and top. But it looks like they're trying to kind of garner control around, you know, not of the Roche Pit itself, but kind of the surrounding areas, you know, kind of that third of the map. And maybe the tier 2 mid would be good for them. They're getting vision down, they're making sure heroes are pressuring there. And it's not necessarily just for them to take Roshan, but you're stopping Lycan from going in.
Right, that's the more important thing. That's the only hope for the Dire right now, is they get Roche. And honestly, even if they get Roche, they're going to like 5-man a tier 1. And it's going to be scary to move any further than that. So it's not like a massive issue, I don't think, if the Dire get it, but it's still obviously their like only path to victory. Oh, nice play.
That was really, really nice. The scan into field, into glimpse, into death of Hani. As three heroes come in and secure the kill. And he was like, I'm in the fog. I'm TPing out. There's nothing that could... Oh, shit. They found me. Made to look so easy by Empire.
And now, like, You found you put this little bit of pressure down bottom, and how would you respond from the Dire? You can't TP in. This is Disruptor. He's just going to glimpse you out. You can't bring enough units, even with the Shrine now, so that's going to be a little bit depressing. Now King Arrow gets some deep vision in here. Again, Nature's Prophet and Disruptor. Vision is what's so crucial for you in enemy territory. Oh, they just saw that warrior place. Really pinged by the Sand King.
Well, they want to try and kill. I'm not sure about this, though. The wall vacuum. Sunstrike misses. And Disruptor will die and Doom. That's a lot of damage from Era's Lifestealer. Lifestealer? Lycan, even. So used to having the Lifestealer from Era roll off the tongue that it kind of just came out on its own. But this was a couple of supports from Empire kind of on their lonesome. The cores spread out across the map to farm, and NIP, they took full advantage of it.
Yeah, it's not too often you get a wall that, like, cuts it off completely like that as well, but they just had nowhere else to go. So just right into the slow. And as long as there is that element of control, I mean, that's what Lycan's best at, right? This Mask of Madness armlet, this is probably one of his more, like, powerful moments in the entire game. He outputs a massive amount of damage. Also, now they're going to be in nighttime for the next 3.5 minutes, so they could perhaps take another engagement with Howl.
And he's ready for mid lane. He wants to go, but the backup he has isn't fast enough. Or maybe, with FN pushing so far forward, he chains now already. The cold snap's there, but the Burrow Strike misses. Sleight of fist, beautifully timed, whether by luck or by skill. FN escapes, and they're looking for the turnaround as well. They know that Epi's down and that Invoker has already cast a couple of spells. Team Empire, they could smoke up and play aggressively now, pushing past the shrine. Looking for that ancient area of the Radiant, but instead, they choose the safe route. Sit back and farm for now. FN still building towards Lincoln Sphere. And it's NIP who are still the team that has to respond to what Empire are doing. Have to defend top. Have to think about Roshan. There are so many things weighing on NIP's mind right now that with a missed opportunity like that to kill the Ember Spirit, it's so demoralizing, honestly.
Yeah. The, perhaps this Aghanim Scepter will start coming into play, though, if they can, you know, if you start pushing it from the Radiant, and I think that's why they've been kind of chill. I think they understand that, you know, this Evoker hits a couple good tornadoes, that leads into, like, a two-man Burrow Strike. Era is going to rip you apart. Like, he will just go straight for the throat. He's going to gut you, like the wolf he is, so.
Oh, they found the Furion. This has been really well played. If they just kill him. just kill him, guys. You got him.
Yeah,
you got
no
him. But yeah, they surge the Sand King, they run forward, they had very little vision of him until, like, the... And I caught a tiny glimpse of him, but... Everything played out nicely by NIP. They find a big kill, they can push into Tier 1 top with Era's ult wearing off, but he's got his Mask of Madness now to chomp down into towers. And all of a sudden, the script kind of flips, and Empire are the ones that are on the other side of the map to where the action's happening. They're nowhere near Roshan to secure it or defend it. They'll have to be looking for tower pressure of their own to maybe force NIP back.
Talk about how that pinged, like, where the sentry was, but that sentry went for the double hit.
You are lagging a little bit. I said everything was working earlier, and apparently it's not, but there's a back wall, the chains come out, but the damage is done, and Darkseer is dead. NIP. They're still having to deal with Ghoststick, who is just creating a barrier between the Darkseer and the rest of his team. This is Team Empire, grouping up as five, and yep. Yeah, NIP can't move towards Roshan, they're having to defend this bottom lane. Epicenter's ready for Hani. Just need a good lock onto a secure target.
Fight this without, just without Darkseer?
Yeah, it's hard though, hey? Maybe with Invoker damage they can do it, but he's got Tornado Sunstrike invoked and queued up, and Empire. They're the ones who fall back, and look at this Crystal Maiden just sprinting down the lane, looking for someone, anyone. They've got the Wolf actually scouting out Disruptor. Kinetic Field is down, but the Sunstrike will secure. If that's all the Empire lose, then fair enough, but... I don't know if they felt... They felt they needed to do something, you know, check Roshan, because both Lycan and Invoker were hiding off the map for quite some time.
Yeah. Probably just that whole, sustain aspect as well, a little bit for the Radiant. They don't really have much that helps the rest of the team, so your Razor's like a little bit low. They don't even have an urn, I don't think, right? Yeah, so it's like, you know, you have an urn there from all these kills your team's been getting. You can just earn up this Razor and this tower is dead, but we've definitely moved away from sustainability items. We don't get too many these days, so it's kind of these one and done situations like that.
Turn and burn. One and done. I don't know. like we used to always see Rubik's buy urn, like every game, just like buy an urn, shove high ground, help people push, and especially in a game where you don't have a hero that can like sit high ground and break tier threes, like yeah. Razor and Ember are like Razor's kind of half of one of those heroes. You know, he builds tanky, but he's not innately a hero that's good at just breaking high ground himself. He needs to drain damage from someone first. Then, you know, urns and soul crests and things like that. I guess I'm being a bit of an idiot and I'm not counting Nature's Prophet because treants definitely help, don't they?
Yeah, they're pretty good, I hear.
They're pretty good at breaking high ground, right? You know, they tank a bit of damage. There's like 50 million of them. Soaking up all the tower hits. He's actually gone for this kind of damage route, you know. Not the Desolator or Maelstrom, but actually Orchid, Shadowblade, and moving into a BKB. Moving into the Rosh Pit with a Wolf Scouting.
Nice, it's a very good balanced build.
It is. You've got stats, damage, you got lockdown kind of silence thing there. You've got Sprout. A Hand of Midas ties it all together. Lovely color. This is the Roshan battle we've been waiting for. The big man's down to half HP. NIP spreading, looking for this initiation. CM coming from the north. His Empire moved back a little bit there. But Nature's Prophet's going to try and spread this map a little and actually moves himself back towards the bottom lane. Now, he doesn't have a TP scroll, which might be noticed here. And his TP's on cooldown for 10 seconds as well. So NIP, if they want to go and fight, there's no better time than now.
Still just biding their time here. There's so much vision, too. Just like this ward over on the other side of the river, helping out the Radiant. Of course, the creeps are there for now, but once they move, they maybe have an idea as to where Era heads. You know, maybe they like see him running bottom or see him running this way, and they just immediately go right back in. Now they're just standing guard, the two supports, holding the pit while the core's farm.
Yeah, but that's the thing. NIP are just standing still. The side lane's being shoved out. Nature's Prophet and Razor both get a good chunk of farm. NIP just... Oh, Hani is pretty much role-playing their entire team, standing AFK on this hilltop, waiting for that initiation moment for themselves.
And now they're also going to have a Lincoln's done here on our Ember Spirit. It's finished in 7 gold, so he should have that for the actual engagement, which makes him obviously much more survivable, especially when we're dealing with such a lack of stuns here on the Dire. Like, you actually can't lock him down.
At all?
You'll have to use, like, both their stuns and kill him during the one. So, like, kill him during the Frostbite or the Burrow Strike or something.
So they have to, like, Tornado, Burrow Strike, Frostbite.
They need the... I guess if they Cold Snap to pop it, actually.
Yeah,
that's
maybe
true.
Well, Roshan, he's regened a bit of HP since he last had to battle in his own little pit here. But Doom walks in. There's a Treant tanking. There's Wolves walking through. And NIP are still in position to try and fight this. I don't know if they're going to smoke and run, but this kind of standoff across the river is becoming more and more awkward for them. Invoker's moved back to farm. Lincoln Sphere is being built up for him. Team Empire, they will smoke now. Sunstrike into the pit to give some vision. Snipes the Treant. Gets him. He's
got
dead.
That money.
He's gone. But Empire are the ones that are going to let loose. They're looking for the wrap. Getting in behind NIP's ranks, and this Treant is scouting out a fair amount.
This wolf is like the false vision, you know?
Yeah, they see, but they don't see. And now they go in. Ember Spirit jumps forward. The Invoker's gone invis, but the glimpse back in the Sonic Storm means he's already dead. The Vacuum Wall is good, but the BKB, Chappie, starts to drain out the damage. Era, he's doomed up, but he's still sprinting forward. His Mask Menace and BKB on. He looks now to chomp down into Ember Spirit. Remnants away. And the damage output from Chappie looked like it might have been able to take down Trixie DS, but it's getting a bit messy here as the glimpse takes him outside of those trees and Invoker arrives. Damage output looks good. The Sunstrike lands, the Ice Walls there, slows them down. And Chappie has to sprint out. NIP, they take down one. The team fight swinging their ways. Apple caught inside the Ice Wall. Cold Snap. The Deafening Blast wasn't even needed. But Team Empire, did anyone buy back from Nip, or was that just so well executed they didn't need to?
Just our Invoker, because he got stacked from the start.
Oh yeah, you're right. And now they're looking for the Disruptor. The Glimpse won't save him, and Mika gets a number there, and into the pit they go. This is going to be huge for them if they can take the Roshan down, but FN, Sleight of Fist with the chains, does a bit of damage. The trouble is that Insania and Trixie are both up on the front lines to sort him out if he gets any closer, and they have to give this one up. Roshan and Aegis will go the way of Era's Lycan.
Very impressive.
NIP, that they find themselves in a position where this game is Now more than winnable again.
Yeah. Found themselves a fight, and they were down 10k in net worth. Like, that is so impressive to win a fight in that situation. I thought Insania on the Crystal Maiden played a fantastic fight there. Very nice angle for the ulti. I mean, a little bit of just good positioning, staying together as a team, that whole situation where they kind of felt that Empire was going to bring that aggression, but it wasn't just the fact that his ulti was in a good spot. He ended it early just to help the control on that Doom, because Doom could have just walked away, because there were still, like, two other heroes inside the freezing field, but he understood that that Doom was going to get out of there if he didn't just, like, stop and help go over and help his Lycan. So, secure that kill, then he moves back forward and keeps throwing out Crystal Novas and stuff, and honestly, just living. Like, he only had Tranquils during that engagement, and you survive that as a Crystal Maiden is kind of crazy.
And now,
now you can
force
staff because of it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I was just looking as well at what Disruptor had, you know, wondering wondering what the money situation's like over there. 2,500 net worth. I was like, maybe you have something to your name. Gloves of Haste and 1,000 gold. Hand of Midas is coming. 30 minutes in, and he's still buying Hand of Midas now. I know someone in chat will probably disagree with this and hate this item decision. Nahaz, hello, man. Nice to see you watching, but
I mean, think about that urn earlier, though. You know, could have had that urn.
Exactly. Like, this is the thing. You know, there are some arguments for late Midases. You know, for heroes that go blink or armlet first, your CK, your sanking, your whatever. You know, you get that primary item, the blink, or you get the armlet, and you get the damage output from that. And then you go back to Midas because you're not a flash farmer. But for a disruptor who could have had Sol Ring Tranquils or Arcane Boots or an urn or you know, half a four staff or the majority of a glimmer cape, I do always wonder, like, why go for this Midas? And I feel like the biggest reason, you know, we talk about the experience, the gold, the attack speed, it's amazing, it's wonderful. I honestly feel like it's one of these situations where Midas is a feel good item, right?
It is.
It's a feel good item.
I think that's what Lil said, right? That was one of his responses to that situation.
I didn't see.
He just said, like, Dota feels so uncertain right now, and it feels like the game, you never really know if you're going to win this game even when you're so far ahead. So, like, the Midas is, because, like, the way comeback mechanics work and stuff, it's just kind of scary. So you buy this Midas because you're like, all right, well, you know, we lose a fight, the game starts going later, I got this Midas. Now I feel really good, you know? I could definitely see that being a nice rationale for it.
Yeah, it's just like, oh God. Dire's career kill. It's like, regardless of how much farm my carries are taking, like, I always loved it when there's like a Naga or an Alc in the game, right, for you supports to get Midas, because the entire map is just like fucked. You can't go out, you can't kill creeps, you can't kill jungle camps because they're all dead. So buying a hand of Midas is just like that, right, I will get some kind of gold and some kind of experience from the map. But in this kind of game, I'm not a big fan, but it's like we're saying, it's one of those things that's just like, it will get you there in the end as long as you don't just lose with the Hand of Midas. The NIP, they're pushing onto tier 2s already. Aegis still in hand. Era holds onto that one. The Glyph is forced as well for Empire.
He's got about 2 minutes left on that Aegis.
But that Glyph kind of, for me, like, telegraphs Empire's going to come back and defend it. Because you don't usually Glyph tier 2s unless you want to death. Because it opens up your tier 3s.
Or you have a really good push happening, which is chapping at bottom.
Exactly. They've kind of faked this one out, and NIP not in a position to respond, so they get the tier 2 up at top lane and look to fight up against this Doom. The Aegis is gone, and the Invoker's doomed up. And comes Ghost Stick with an Aegis Prophet. A few hits there. The Static Storm will catch, but the BKB's used by Lycan. Gets out into his ult form, and he tries to run away as well. Sand King's going to die in the back end. A 2 for nothing there, and well.
FN passes the Lincolns just as the Burrow Strike is connecting onto the Doom. That was sick. Just puts a raid on top, and then Hodge's like, welp. So much for that.
And the cores escape, though. They give 2 supports for a tier 2, a bit of chip damage onto the tier 3. It's like half HP. It's not bad. But NIP lose the Aegis very early on and didn't have a way to really turn the fight. But bottom lane, Trixie. Darkseer's on the run. Is there another slight change? There is in a second. And he has Blink, but the Vacuum. Whoa, ho, ho! Trixie, perfectly timed. And Invoker comes in as well. There's no mana left back on this FN Ember Spirit. But Invoker doesn't want to commit to this one. They keep Trixie alive at the very least. Well, that was some gorgeous play there from the two of them.
Yeah, but meanwhile in your top lane, oh, this Razor, okay, maybe he's a little bit deep. That's 3 heroes, but
Chappie on the run. Ghost Stick, he's spotted out soon enough. Dust is coming off cooldown in Era's, Honey's inventory soon enough. Oh god, no.
Man, that 50-50 coin flip, man. brutal.
Go north, go south, and he went south. Nature's Prophet went north. That is very, very sad. That dust, I see him switch it from his backpack, and I'm like, he'll have it in time, and just waiting, like, come on. Come on, don't be grayed out anymore. It just took way too long for that dust to come back.
I will say, I think he's definitely on the right idea with the Aghanim Scepter this game, right? All those treants.
Nasty. Is Hani okay? Ghoststick's not committing. When's the next Roshan? 2 minutes until we find out. It's become a bit of a stalemate across the map. Both teams hiding on their sides of the river. Neither one really feeling the smoke movement towards the other. But NIP, they've passed the laning stage. They've weathered the storm of CIS aggression for the first 35 minutes. They have items, Trent. They've got some big items now. You know, looking at Greaves, Blink Force, and a Lotus Orb being built by Trixie. Invoker is going to have his Octarine soon. Sand King's like, yeah, whatever. I'm going to buy
it. Got to win the 10k fight again.
Yeah. That they do.
Yeah, we do have a Butterfly, though, onto Chappie, which I do like. It's a nice choice. More movement speed. Whenever you need it, just the Flutter. Of course, very popular on Razor. And then up against his Lycan. That is a lot of damage reduction. Don't really want to buy an MKB, but he's going to be forced into it here for Aera, so Nyx is out on the AC he'd planned on.
But, Trent.
But.
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 But. Actually stunning or like locking down this Lycan seems really difficult, hey?
That is not easy.
They've got like Searing Chains and, I mean, Sprout during the BKB, but wait
until this Disruptor Midas pays off, though.
And guess the Aghanim Scepter, woo! But I've got to say, low-tier trash player, which is Era, is currently being a very high-tier player and is keeping a Quelling Blade to get out of the Sprout. I really like that. I really like to see that.
Surely people would forget to do that.
He's not getting RTZ'd here. Definitely not. But no,
yeah,
no.
There were some serious profit problems at that major. Yeah. The trees, man.
I mean, Burning got RTZ'd at one point. It was SC. I think SC or U9 got RTZ'd as well. Because they had a Mithril Hammer in their inventory and a Quelling in their bat in their stash backpack thing. That was nasty.
All right. Smoke up here from the Radiant. There was a circle around the area from Mickey. So he's just like, all right, I think they're over here, guys. And then they smoke and they're moving through mid. So we'll see if they know. Looks like they're kind of, you know, look where they're playing here on the dire. They're like, eh, maybe something's going on here. Oh, Aera, no. It's a good thing there's not that nice deep ward in here. That's kind of a classic at this point in the game, but.
They find him. Just looking at what Trixie's doing, hiding in the trees like he always does.
Yeah. That's an okay find. I mean, this one guy, look at Hani, but they really wanted that core, of course, and oh, not gonna, okay. Chance to turn into the mid lane. So we're still holding Alpha Wolf with the Blink Dagger, the Force Staff, a lot of mobility. I mean, we're talking about trying to control the Lycan, but although that's difficult, they can definitely kite away from him. So yeah, you try and wait out that ultimate, wait out his BKB, and then move on him. He is down to 8 seconds, and Lycan is a hero that is very sad. They lower and lower his BKB gets.
I'm just looking and thinking, like, an Abyssal or a Hex would be good for Empire, and, you know, Nature's Prophet is closing in on one. Maybe that's going to be their ticket to victory.
I mean, honestly, Hex, though, on Lycan is just, like, so eh.
Exactly, right? I mean, maybe you hex him, then sprout
him.
You
hex him anyway.
You hex him, then sprout him, but he's gonna lose his Quelling Blade soon. He's actually already swapped it out. Never mind. But that MKB coming out onto Lycan is pretty huge when the Butterfly was the last item to be picked up by Chappie's Razor. But if they get this Roshan uncontested, which it looks like they will, they've got the Aegis over onto FN's Ember.
Oh, man. He can just go hard in these fights now that Shiva's guard, too.
He can just walk on in. I just have to make sure to split, though. Team fight out of NIP is pretty freaking huge.
This fight is the true test. I mean, the other fight was difficult to win, and they did it, but this one is, I would say, the next level, you know? You still haven't completed this MKB, so you're kind of at this half item on your Lycan. They have everything finished up on the Radiant that they really need right now. Perhaps the last thing would be this Lotus Orb, if that's what it's going to be from Opochka.
Where is Doom? He's wandering around. They might
just hang on to that shrine. Mid.
FN wanted it. He blinked in forward, but Trixie was quick on his feet, still with the blink and force staff available, got out, and now he's walking a dangerous path, though. They've seen him and they've pinged him. They know where Trixie is. As I get a bit of lag here. I don't know. Trent, are you in game still? Have I lost Trent as well?
I lost you for a second there. That was weird.
I got some big lag, my dude. Like, my game lagged. I don't know. Maybe the goblins are back again. Maybe someone's ruining the JD brand.
The goblins are here.
From the inside out. They just screwed me, dude. I think we're okay for now,
though. It's not better now, though.
Lycan, bottom lane. Do they have another chains? That's the question. In 1 second, they do. Ooh, FN has to blink and slight chains, but he won't guess the correct way. Era has made a beeline for the trees and will be able to escape back to safety, as well as Hani, who was waiting around, lurking in the trees as well.
They got the ward down here, but sadly, it took 2 centuries. They did eventually. No forward vision here from Empire.
But it's definitely them on the front foot again. NIP, you see them on the map, all grouped up as four. One hero across the map is Trixie's Darkseer. Yeah, they just feel so scared. Like, you know, we saw in the first 15 minutes, they were smoking, looking for ganks, finding kills with Sunstrike, and setting up with, like, Hani and Insania. But now, well, maybe with a vacuum back, no, it's not quite enough. Ember gets away from the Burrow Strike of Sand King. He's burnt through all of his mana and, I believe, all of his remnants. Yeah, only had one remaining. FN survives, and that's how difficult it is to kill. And this is why they've not been smoking out and looking for kills, because it's so bloody hard. You have people like Ember Spirit and Razor on the front lines with their Remnants and Lincolns and BKBs. Nature's Prophet has Shadowblade and ways to TP and escape, and honestly, Doom and Disruptor just haven't been showing for the past 20 minutes. They've just been hiding, farming, waiting to see what happens. So NIP don't have valid targets, they don't have valid objectives to go and get apart from like tier 2 mid and bot lane. Trent, what do they do?
Good question. They try and rat a little bit, I guess, but FN, now he's going to find CM. Help a ghost stick, that's easy.
That's the complete opposite story. It's like CM tanking of easy, valid targets. Invoker maybe a little bit more difficult because of Octarina Lincolns.
Notice he also went with the Blink Dagger, which is something that has fallen off heavily on Invokers. We almost like never see the Blink anymore. Which surprise, you know, it's weird. You like watch all these pro games, and I'm expecting these blinks to come out, and they were just kind of a dead item for a while. Everyone just getting maybe a little bit greedier, wanting these like Octarine cores and then like double defensive items or something. And you have a Midas anyway, so you're like don't feel that good spending 2,200 gold. But
it's like all about pacing now, because you know before it used to be like brown boots, Midas. And then you'd go, you know, blink, or like Yule's blink, or you'd go blink boots of travel, then your Aghanims would come later. But now it's about the brown boots Midas Aghanims. Like, Aghanims has jumped in the past like 3 or 4 months, it's jumped from second or third item to first item. You buy it as quickly as you can. But yeah, it's about pacing, and Invoker currently locked in chains. We'll be okay with the shrine, but in jumps FN again. This is how aggressively he can play. With a slight forward, he damages everyone at NIP. In the meantime, I've had to defend top lane as well, because Era sitting up there with the Treants and Razor chipping away at it.
Look at this patch, though. You commit quite a bit from an Ember there, honestly. I mean, most heroes would have to commit a lot more for that, and that's one of the benefits of Ember, in order to do that much damage and get out and everything, but all it costs them is like a couple shrines, so still feeling well to be okay.
The combos here, though, from NIP, they clear through one, Disruptor's gone. Chappie has to BKB and turn to fight with the Satanic. He's got the damage and the life steal as well, but it's not enough up against Era's Lycan, who's just chomping on into him, and now comes down the Ice Wall. Ember Spirit is dead, but the Aegis will respawn him. The question is, the answer's no. Before I can even finish my question, Hani cannot stun into the timing, and now the Lotus Orb back onto the CM. There we go with the Ember Spirit. Gonna slide forward as well. The damage looked good. The Sunstrike flying out won't connect, and with the Doom on the front lines, the Ember still has the free reign to jump through this fight. The wall is still available, and they turn with a Cold Snap and the Forge Spirit. And well, Doom is just so tanky, he doesn't really care. He tanks up all of that damage, and Chappie has returned. They'll move in towards the bottom lane now, and it's everything gone from NIP. Their combo has been wasted almost. The racks have fallen, and in they run. EMP burns the Ember, and the Sunstrike not going to land, but the Static Storm finally drops. The meatballs down onto Chappie, but guess what? He has Satanic again with Lotus Orb down on him. The gem is down, and Trixie has the Force Staff away. Era finally goes in with a BKB, and his shapeshift. He'll slice down one. Disruptor is gone. Mickey finds a kill onto Ghostick in the back, but it's NIP who managed to defend, even with all of their spells and their combos gone, through Lycan's ultimate with a BKB, just charging through the ranks of a Team Empire.
Yeah, that's going to give us a 3,500 gold swing, so not too shabby, but more importantly, it's the experience. They do gain experience on the Radiant, but on the Dire, they're going to gain a total of 7,284. So quite a few levels, and that includes 2,000 for our Darkseer here, and that puts them up to level 23, closing in up to like level 25 and stuff too, maybe getting a little bit beefier for himself. But still a very difficult game for the Dire, I would say. You're pretty happy overall getting at the tier 3 bottom.
Got a tier 2 mid, but I don't know, dude. Losing tier 3 range racks and your mid tier 3 is on 300 HP. It feels like a matter of time until Empire will find themselves even more of an advantage. Invoker trying to deal with the Ember. Tornado won't catch him, and well, the Lincolns is popped, but fortunately, Hani doesn't land the Burrow Strike. He used his Yules to pop the Linkers there, but the Frostbite will now land in with the Freezing Field. There's a jump back, but the Sunstrike not going to land. Era will find the final killing blow.
And that was the 4-staff at the time.
Really well played.
Yeah, I mean, they don't have that much control of the Dire, but when it's, you know, 3 heroes versus 1, and you can just throw everything on top of them, it is pretty handy. And there will be an additional one there, and that's one of the other big benefits of actually getting the Blink Dagger on our Invokers, that we can now build into the Scythe and feel very confident about it. And Blink Octarine, Scythe Octarine, obviously some very nice synergies here.
This Furion, though, Trent, is pretty huge right now. Bloodthorn is nearly up. He has BKB, AC, Hex, and Orchid, and, well, these items are all good and shiny and valuable. I was wondering if the Invoker catches him there, if Nature's Prophet doesn't just die straight up, but they don't see him. They don't sniff him out over in this jungle. Empire can breathe a sigh of relief that NIP kind of swing back, win a team fight, but they don't get any real objectives. And Roshan will be respawning in 30 seconds time. A quick one here. A fast respawn for Empire. Radiant Courier. Hiding up on the high ground. NIP knew it was there. They actually came across to hit it a couple more times. I think it got dinked by the wolf once or something like that. But they won't find it now. And you just see the rush towards this middle part of the map. They look for the fight onto the Doom. Ice Wall's there, and that should slow him enough to get the kill. As Lycan actually shapeshift forward for this one. The damage is amazing from Era. They've got to shove this into something else, though. If only they knew that Roshan was... Oh, they do. They do know Roshan's alive.
Yeah, they have a wolf in there, I think.
They do?
Yeah. So, benefits of this as well is that they're going to get in there before this Blink Dagger is done for Disruptor. And, like, even that little engagement onto the Doom, if there's a Blink Static Storm there with the high mobility of the Radiant, it's possible that you just all get totally screwed. So, the Roche Pit would have been very scary too. Yeah, man, that Courier's having a rough life.
No, I don't care about the Courier. So, you know how the Team Empire, they unlock shrines by killing a Tier 3? Nature's Prophet is just sending Treants.
I was just non-stop.
Non-stop. Oh, yeah. Like, that shrine, it was maybe like half HP or something, but he's been setting Treants for a while now, and he's going to start moving them up to the northern shrine as well at this point, it looks like. And NIP have to clear this. They just lost the shrine to nothing but Furion Treants.
These guys are adorable. They have, like, their little yellow eyeball thing drops on the ground when they die, too.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Aww. Pretty funny. Sentient beings. Their brains.
Eh.
Look at that. Just like a bleh.
Dota.
Oh, dear.
See a Razor Aghanims? I don't remember the last time I saw one of these bad boys.
Oh, wow.
This, you know, still best place to at least consider it. I don't know if I'm sure he's going to finish, to be honest.
I mean, we didn't even really used to see it from Ace's Razor,
no.
Right? He used to go like BOT's Manta. Like he went Mjolnir and things, like AC was definitely one of his big
and
items.
Like and stuff.
Yeah. Wow.
We'll have to see. Obviously, very nice item for game plan at this point, so it makes sense. Then you get this refresher after, right? That was the old Razor Dream.
The old Razor Dream, Ags Refresher. Was that TI4? It wasn't TI3, it was like around TI4, wasn't it, when we had this whole... Yeah. the whole craze about Death Prophets and razors and pushing and killing buildings and all that shit. Yeah.
She did pretty well at the Major. I liked seeing her.
Yeah, it was refreshing to see Death Prophet back for just back for a little bit. Trixie aiming for Chappie. This is dangerous, though. Chappie puts the Static Link onto the Lotus Orb target, and Trixie will vacuum back with a Static Storm. Whiffs out, and the Darkseer looks like he's already dead. Good Tornado comes out and does catch onto Doom. They've killed off Disruptor, but after he's already popped his spells, and Mikke actually getting the nice HP heal back from his spells, but it's just too much damage out from Team Empire. Well, the Burst Strike out from...
Darkseer buyback coming in.
They've got the stuns, but the Satanic from Chappie turns back to fight. Where is the Ember Spirit? He's actually remnanted back out and away to escape from this. NIP, they kill off four. I don't even know if they needed that buyback.
Yeah, probably not. Came in with the wall. Maybe he was just hoping to secure the third kill as well, but vacuum was still on cooldown when he'd gotten there. Wow, and that fight actually started out very well for the Radiant, because it was clearly a very nice bait, first off, by Trixie. You know, well played on the Darkseer there, just kind of running in circles as allies are closing in. But there was going to be a big epicenter from Hani, but it was scaled up by the stream. It was before we come off, so that was a fight without epicenter. However, it was just Era in the middle of it, unwailing.
Yeah, that Lycan just, like, ran at people. It was absolutely insane, and... Honestly, when you look at the Disruptor throwing down a kind of, you know, hopefully this ult lands on someone before I die, Static Storm, that's when you know things are going poorly. You know, it's a little bit out of position maybe, a little bit too far forward, but now melee racks, and it looks like a full lane here for NIP as Era just chomps down the buildings. The glimpse back though, the BKB will cancel that out, and they had the Sprout place to try and lock him in at the same time. But NIP, they come out storming here, and they also get a shrine to their name. This is big for them. I mean, the game swung a little bit when we had that fight up towards top, but this is much, much bigger.
Yeah, that actually might have been a situation where your low BKB actually helped you. Just having it available again there for that glimpse might have cost him his life in other situations if that was like a 9-second BKB cooling down or something like that, but... this is the threat of your Lycans or your Tinies, you know? You feel like you're just beating this team, and then you make one mistake, and this guy just takes your buildings. You know, your Terror Blade, he's the other guy who's mostly doing it right now. They get hit, so they have the Rax advantage now on NIP, 27-27. Still a bit of a goal differential, but, I mean, you just dropped at 10k.
Invoker is, like, maxed out now. He went for the Hex.
I mean, wow, that experience advantage, even.
Yeah, he could think about... Oh, he's gone for BKB. I was wondering if he goes for a Refresher, but now he can swap his Blink out for a BKB. What are we looking at now? Experience? Oh, yeah. Okay. Well, that's an interesting graph. That's a long old slide down from, what, a 15k lead to a 10k deficit now. Team Empire once held and now are wishing they still did. Net worth is sitting about 9,000 lead for Empire still. But it's kind of... dumped in onto weird and wonderful items, you know? Ember Spirit went for this Maelstrom Mjolnir, Shiver's Guard, kind of semi-defensive, semi-offensive, Octarine Lincolns, you know, he's got ways to hide and jump, but...
Still kind of feels like he needs a BKB even after all that, you know? Yeah,
there's that, but also the fact that it feels like after 30 minutes or so, he hasn't been dishing out as much damage as is needed of him. And Razor is also one of those weird heroes that, you know, over time during teamfights can gain damage and is tanky and is a difficult hero to kill.
Oh, and the gem is back here.
When he's hexed up and vacuumed back into the perfect wall! Oh, they've got him. Invoker now with a Deafening Blast through onto Chappie, but the BKB's there. Razor turns the fight, tries to drain the damage away from Lycan, sprints himself back into the trees, but Era turns the fight. The Satanic is not going to keep you alive through this! NIP, they've killed off two big heroes with Ghost Stick as well as the Poshuk in the background. They're held in place. The Freezing Field from Insania! Oh, Hani comes in with the Epicenter, but it doesn't really matter. Not needed at all. But FN will spirit away back to safety. The trouble is, safety is his home. Well, there's no one living here anymore.
It's close!
What was close? Was someone doomed?
Oh, the doom on Mikke was just a little scary. It was getting a little low. But, you know, Trixie Aura helping out.
But yeah, you are these tanky heroes that are difficult to kill. But if you're killed off at the start of a team fight, you are, like, meaningless. Even if you buy back. Because you need desperately need as Empire, these fights to draw, you know, 20, 30, 40, a minute and a half to try and drain damage, chip away, but more, I think more importantly, you have to burn the combo of NIP and try and re-engage after, because they have such strong spells.
It took 160 damage that fight, and Lycan was still hitting for over 300. So, you know, that's a little disappointing.
NIP might just finish here. They're going to take the safe route and bail away from the Ember Spirit. Yule Scepter for Hani, to allow him to force and blink. Back away.
It's a very impressive game from Nip. I mean, they're looking pretty poor. There was a 10k advantage, and the split push was there, and they were wrapping all the...
Okay, you've lagged out. I'm going to recall you, Trent. I'm gonna see if this works. I mean, we're still using Skype. We should be on Discord or something, honestly. This is
my hello.
I'm sure you just blame me for this.
Yeah, I will blame you. Why?
Yeah. Because something broke.
Classic. So I'm alive now.
Yeah, you're good now. I just don't know why this happens.
So, I don't know, man. You guys got those gremlins. They've been laying dormant. But, all right, well, quickly to summarize, basically, I mean, what did we say, right? They were going to have a hard time catching him with split pushing. They couldn't catch him split pushing. They built this big lead on the Radiant. And the only way that Nip could win was, like, some crazy aggression that came into them, which is what happened that first big wraparound, like, when we were looking for that Roche fight. It was a little needless from Empire, kind of felt like, you know? Like, anyway, they're going to try it again.
I do catch Trixie, but he's got Lotus and Shivers and Vacuum and Wall. He drops them all and... FN and Chappie trying to find another target. Disruptor's already dropped his ultimate, but Mika's still alive. Half HP on his Invoker. They drop a sentry now. He's got the Doom on him, and it's his life that will be taken. Trixie does find a kill in the back and on the Disruptor at the very least, but Invoker dying there. Holding on to buyback. Might be something that Empire can utilize, but it's got to be Ghostick who TP's back home to defend these lanes that are pushing in.
It's a good place to fight. It's highly unlikely, I think, that the entirety of the Dire is there. So they just like try and quickly move there, try and take an outnumbering engagement, and they will find it. So no big vacuum combinations, and that's basically what's been winning it so far for them.
It has been Trixie Dota. Everything's been his. Roshan's alive very quick again. And NIP do obviously know that's up, so they'll try and keep these lanes pushed out as far as they can. But yet again, another problem. You know, Chappie still survivable, still building into survival items. Going for a Skadi will help him.
Yeah,
will help him kite the Lycan a little bit, but not during shapeshift form.
The Aghanim's dream was just a little too far fetched, I have to say. I was surprised to even see it queued up in the first place.
But like, where's your Hex? Where's your Abyssal? Where are these, you know, hard stuns and lockdown items that you kind of? You know, want to see your Ember Spirit have, or maybe your Doom.
Well, that's why we were talking about a Jug potential, right? For that, like, Blink Abyssal sort of situation. But, oh, Hani doesn't go in. He knew he was about to die with the Wolf, but even Hani's not that crazy, he says. And probably because he has no buyback.
I was wondering if he might still die. That's a good four staff. Straight past him.
Oh, he doesn't have the gem anymore anyway.
Oh, well. And Invoker, they killed him bottom lane, but he won't have to expend his buyback. Probably one of the bigger things here for NIP. And sure enough, they've got Cheese on Ember, and they've got Aegis over on the Razor, but there's the combo coming in. Epicenter's good. Half HP now on this Razor. Sunstrike will land. They've killed off the Aegis. It has gone. Tornado will clip him at the very, very beginning there. An EMP Ice Wall will have to PKB. Chappie retreats and runs away. Era's caught inside the Sprout. Static Storm has dropped as well with a Hex now. Oh, this Lycan's going to die. He's got no way of escape. Maybe he has to buy back, but he's got no ulti. Now the Crystal Maiden drops. 90 seconds without Insania. Mika, he's got so much to do here. Another wall
he's
comes down. It's
a
refresher. It's a nice blink burrow strike, and in they jump. Trixie's there with the Iron Shell to kill off the Doom. But is it going to be enough? The Satanic, the Yule Scepter is up. That purges it off. He doesn't have it anymore. Another Yule Scepter Razor. He's a flying hero all of a sudden. No more lightning for him. But Mika, he's got the DPS. Alacrity pops out onto him. Two more hits is all he might need. But he's hexed and glimpsed. Sent back to where he came. The vacuum finally will kill off the Furion. But it's Disruptor who will hold their attention and TP away. One buyback there was used by the Lycan, but NIP hold yet again, Trent.
It's costly, but not structurally. at least. So,
it's effective.
See if they can capitalize on this.
It's effective. And now you have
and,
no
yeah,
Aegis.
Doom, man. Maposhka just, he couldn't find the Doom. Like, no one could pop that Linket, and he wanted the Invoker so bad, because Darkseer had already blown his load. He's gonna try and sneak his way in here to find a hero this time.
He's got the Doom now onto Lycan at the very least, but I don't know if this is just a, hey, guys, I got a Doom, let's do something, please. The Glimpse back, there we go, this is what we're looking for. Remnants forward, damage is good, that's the dieback, you're right. Lycan, 120 seconds without him, and all of a sudden NIP, we're talking about how well they're doing and how well they held, might have just given away a little bit more than they thought they were, with Lycan dying. And once again, back onto the shoulders of Trixie and Mickey. The Darkseer and the Invoker have to defend the base, but there's no cheese, no Aegis. Oh, there is a cheese, my bad. The cheese actually got given to the Razor, I guess, at the end of the team fight, but no Aegis for him. So if he gets hexed up and, you know, held in place like he was in the previous fight, he could potentially just get burst down.
I need more seconds. And they'll try and push out every lane, and they'll still have about 30 seconds or so where they can have a full 5-man push in one of these lanes, I would say. Trying to get very aggressive.
Invis Invoker, Lincoln's is popped, four staff forward, Stag Storm's there, but Mickey has a Lotus Orb on him, and Lincoln's
there's
back
a Lotus
up
from Insania.
And he's also got the
as
BKB.
Well as
wait, this Invoker can just shove BKB into his inventory at this point. Get ready to use it, but he's holding the blink. There we go. Blink back, FN, jump forward. There's the back wall, but there's no combo to go with it. NIP went ready, and comes the Epicenter, and they've killed off the Ember Spirit. He has buyback ready, but Chappie's been left to his own devices, held in place. The Ice Wall's there, has to use his BKB. They've got the DPS back onto Insignius because Maiden surged away. Not going to die just yet. And now the Lotus Orb, the Glimpse is the fun. It starts to come out. Oh, Razor. Sunstruck. Stunned. Hexed. And it looks like about to die. No cheese, no Satanic. No HP, the Yule Scepter's back and forth, but the Tornado will be the securing force as Trixie will finally die to the Searing Chains there in the burn of
how
the Ember Spirit, but FN is somehow still doing damage. Mickey actually runs forward. Oh, do you have a Hex? You do. Off cooldown now. Lincoln's Fear is ready for this Ember Spirit. Tornado up. Cold Snap and Hex. You've got the pop and you've got the lockdown now. Light, all you have to do, Insania Frostbite forward. They've got the meatball and the damage. Oh, yes, they do. 122 seconds for them, Ember Spirit, to respawn. And NIP, somehow they just manage every time when they're holding high ground to come out through the woodwork and pull out the big combos.
Wow. Mickey, man. The speed on that Cold Snap Hex as well at the end, despite like just playing some crazy ass fight, he is really on point right now with his Invoker. And you know, it's Nip who tends to be the Invoker squad in the Empire squad in these situations. You know what I mean? They often have these leads, but see if they can close it.
Oh, Era, can you survive through this? The Force Snap is good with the BKB as well. The Sunstrike will land onto Ghost Stick. And in comes Trixie. He's got Iron Shell's Glow, the BKB's Force, but the right clicks are more than enough to kill him off, and good game's called. Empire, they go from having, what, a 20,000 almost net worth lead in this game to three good, okay, very, very good team fights from NIP in a row to secure this one. But game one. Game one of a best of three. Potentially two games to go. NIP, they look strong. They look strong with their draft. I don't know about the laning phase. I was worried, but what do you think, Trent?
Honestly, it feels like that Razor was such a liability. If I have a Juggernaut this game, I have a Blink Buyer, I have an Abyssal Buyer, I have a guy who is a Healing Ward that gives us sustain so we can actually pressure in Siege, because they got to the situation where they should have won the game. If that was a Juggernaut, they would have won the game. I'm not saying obviously they'd be in the same situation maybe if it was a Jug instead of a Razor, but basically when you're approaching like that, they kind of used all of the resources of the Razor. He gets down to 25% HP and they have to leave. They what are you going to do? Like, Remnant back to Fountain and bottle him three times? That's not going to do anything. So they just have to back away, and they're just popping shrines on the high ground as Nip. And that bought him enough time to get some items going, get some levels going, and then all it takes for them is that one Wombo combo they looked for. And obviously, Darkseer came out big right at the end of Kiev. These teams can play him very well, so not too shocking to see Nip take a win with it.
Yeah, I'm also looking at like Nature's Prophet's item build, and you know, I like those items on Furion. I think they're great, but I do wonder if he'd gone for an Aghanim's Octarine Refresher, if NIP would ever have had the chance to actually get across the river, because that Furion was farmed as all hell, but it didn't feel that way in team fights. I don't know if he just spent maybe a little bit too much time split pushing onto tier threes and racks, and maybe if he was in the fights to begin with, could have gone differently for Empire. But it's so hard to say. With Nature's Prophet, yep. who has such a dynamic sort of flowing, item algorithm where you're like, okay, I can think of this. There are no key items that you desperately need like you have with so many other heroes. But we'll see. Game 2 coming up. Empire versus Nip. Mr. Cat European Invitational. We'll take a little break and we'll be back soon. Won't we, Trent?
Yes, we shall.
Won't we, Trent?
It'll be great.
Okay?
Mr. Cat.
Okay, Trent?
Okay.
See you guys in a couple of minutes. I'm going insane.